Giannascoli, and that was just a performance of Rain Dance by Alice Gomez and Marilyn Rife. I had to look because the second name, I always want to make sure I get it right. This is a great beginner intermediate four ballad piece. After Yellow, After the Rain, this is about the next piece I would assign. And I have to say it would definitely be after Yellow, After the Rain. I played Yellow, After the Rain in college and I'd never played this piece. And after learning it just recently to present it in a video, I realized it's actually more difficult than Yellow After the Rain. There's some more interval changes. There's an octave. You go from a third to a fourth quite a bit in the right hand, a fifth to a fourth quite a bit in the left hand, as well as that octave that goes back and forth. And when you get to a larger barred instrument for a younger student, that's a bit challenging. So, definitely Yellow After the Rain or something similar, you know, Zen Wanderer or C Refractions before a piece like this. And then this piece would be just before maybe an etude by Musser, like the one in B major for four mallets. So what do? We first have to get our sounds together. And I did a stick change in the middle. I think the chorale should have a softer mallet, so I try and do it as efficiently as I can. And I'll get to that when I get up to the chorale. For the main part of the piece, I'm using a M153 in the top three voices by Firth on rattan. It's a great rubber mallet with an extra piece of rubber tubing around it, and then two pieces of Dr. Scholl's moleskin on top of that rubber tubing. Then I have an M152, which is a step softer than these, in the bass. It's got a much thicker piece of rubber tubing around it. It's slightly heavier, and then I have a couple pieces of Dr. Scholl's moleskin around that. This is a mallet, sometimes it's in my bass bag, but it's one of the lightest, more articulate bass mallets that I have. And so then I put some yarn around it. A decent amount, probably about 80 wraps of this because it's pretty thick yarn. So. This mallet is one of the ones that does not have a weight in it. It's just the 150 has a heavy brass weight inside, which makes it much heavier. So just the 153s and then a 152 in the bass. And what you want to do, I would highly recommend to get started on this. Don't run the piece. Don't learn large sections. The first week of this piece, I would groove on each one of the licks that comes up with the sticking patterns. And so, that's the different paradiddle patterns, right? First. And then the finish. And try to emphasize the right hand. The left hand is just kind of filling in the spaces. And then when that one comes up as well, just repeat over and over, back and forth. The same here. I wait with the dynamics just a little bit. That third line, which is where the repeat sign is, I bring it up just a hair. And now you're going to notice I've done some different things with it. I've changed a couple patterns here and there, added some low notes here and there. If you're auditioning for Regions or Allstate in New Jersey with this piece, don't make any changes in the music. Play it like it's written, okay? But I felt like I wanted to add some things and fool around, so I did. It's always bothered me that that third line, when you do the repeat, doesn't the second time do with the double right from C to D. So anyway, you can hear what I've done to change it and add things, and you're the interpreter, so you basically do what you like, but if you're being evaluated on a point system, I might not do it if I were in high school in New Jersey. So anyway, I do save a little bit with the dynamics for this, because it reaches up to that fourth, and I want to emphasize that a little. So I'll start at a low mezzo forte on this piece, and then when I go up to the fourth, that'll become the higher mezzo forte. And you just practice, just like we had spoken about in Yellow After the Rain, here many times, right? Here too. And get that, when you come off that third, boom, it pops open to the fourth. My elbow comes out just a little, so I'm over the pipes. You don't want to go like this because I'll be over the string. Make sure your elbow comes out more for the fourth. Here for the fifth, when it comes up later, my elbow's at a normal space here. My elbow comes in just a little, so that fourth is over both pipes. I can't tell you how important elbow positions are to being in a good place on the bar. Not just the right bar, but over the right spot on the bar. Really fine-tune your elbow positions and pay attention. Slow practice will help you evaluate that so much. Use your ear, but also do peek over and check that you're in a good position so the bar sings when you want it to. All right, so I would practice quite a bit of grooving, just individual licks repeated over and over and over with a metronome. All right, and then without a metronome, so you get used to it. Now you'll notice at the end of the third line in the repeated measures, I diminuendo. And I want to do that because I want to give myself room to come up again when I start to reach over here. So that part right there is stronger. All right, and then I'm just going to fade away. Now listen. The fadeaway, that's one of the spots I changed, and you're welcome to steal anything you want from this video. The fadeaway gets out of the way so I can pop this back up again. This is supposed to be loud, but if you play this section too loud, you're going to be sloppy. I have to say, learning this recently, I was kind of dead set on doing it this way, and then bringing in the four mallet approach right there when I get to the A to D. But I found my hands tightened up so much, which they shouldn't, doing that I play it much better and more loosely right there with that sticking pattern. And I diminuendo a little bit on each part there, and then back up for this. I have to say, that spot, I had to practice a lot extra. Before I practice longer sections of the piece, I would set the metronome slowly. Let's say the piece I'm going to try and play at 100. Well, I would set the metronome just recently at 80 and do it a bunch of times without a mistake, if possible. We all make mistakes, right? We're human, but do the best you can. Try and practice without mistakes. Then 85. Then 90, 95, 100. Now, what I have students do often with things that have to be worked up, scales and arpeggios, repertoire. Let's say we're going to play it at 100. Maybe 2 weeks before, I'm going to be playing it at 120. It might be a little messy, but then 100 feels relaxed, settled in. It's easier for me, less stress. So I wouldn't recommend practicing it at 120 the day before you have to play it somewhere. You want it to settle in at the right tempo. But early on, weeks before, I might do it. So then it sounds not so kind of tense and like I am playing it too fast. So when I practice it at 120, if I play it at 100, it's going to sound kind of easier to the ear. All right, so I recommend that. Not where you're going to hurt your hands, but faster than the tempo. And stop doing that, though, 2 to 3 weeks before you have to play something. All right, after I fade, this spot here, I want to bring it back up. That's a decision I made learning the piece. I may change my mind sometime, but I play the B flat to the G and C on the loud side, mezzo forte maybe. I bring it down to the A and crescendo back up to mezzo forte again for the B flat. This time, the second time when I repeat it, I take it all the way down. Here's another spot you have to practice because of that jump. Now, I take it all the way down so that when I'm down here in this register, I can start nice and warm and then climb, climb, climb up to the rolls, to the end of this section. All right? I don't want to do this. Four times. Piano forte, piano forte, piano forte. It's kind of boring. So I think I like a long line, which is my general approach to something anyway. So I get it soft, maybe stay soft the first part of the phrase. The second time a little more, 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 and a ritardando at the end. I used to be more concerned about playing those rolls in time, and I really worked on it. Once I played them in time, I hated it. I felt like it rushed through too much. So I do think you should play that at a slower tempo overall. Ritardando to set it up, but then play it slower anyway, so it doesn't sound rushed. And make sure we hear this. So what I'm doing, and I have a lot of people come in and play with the left hand in the middle of the bars on E flat and B flat. I'm exaggerating a little, I'm playing a little too heavy, but you can't hear the movement. So I play this on the edge. Support the crescendo, but make sure you don't overpower your melody by playing the left hand in the middle when it's just supporting notes and the right hand on the edge when it's the main melody. There's a spot in Frogs that's like that too in the chorale, and I forgot to mention it when I did the Frogs video. It's basically the same thing, and it's E flat and B flat in the left hand. Play that on the edge as well so we hear that that movement in the right hand. All right. Take a breath for a second here. I have to tell you, those thirds are hard to get every time and to get consistently and have a nice bounce. Practice that. Practice all this quite a bit. Again, in this tarantella section, it always reminds me of pirate music. I would say make sure that you just, again, groove with the metronome. This piece, the dynamics are kind of scarce, so you're going to have to do something here. I hit it strong at the beginning of this, at the 6-8, but then I back off. And I think of these first two sections as kind of mezzo piano. That one and this. And then the next spot, mezzo forte. Repetition of each little phrase is always a little stronger than the first because it leads us to the next one. And when you come in with the doubles, I hear people pound that sometimes. Don't pound it right away. Ease it in so that everything sounds like a nice long build. We don't want any jagged, punchy entrances all of a sudden, okay? So this part would probably be, to me, forte. When you start bringing in these fits, and then there, needs it. It's like the climax of the section. It really has to have a heaviness to it. And that support adds a lot to it. All right, don't let the left hand drift away too soon, but then once we reach that fortissimo, we're still punchy for a bit, but we start our diminuendo. I do a double left right there. Four. Work on that fade. All right, and we don't need anything. Anything like that. I think a straight line, long line of diminuendo is the best way to go there. Okay? Now, my stick tray is never in front of the marimba. I just did it to show you that I'm changing mallets and talk about for a second, how do we do a quick, efficient stick change? First, I wouldn't have any extra mallets on the tray, right? I put these down and they're set just like they were in my hand. And before I started, I did the same with these mallets. So they're in my hand. I practiced setting them down so that I can reach over and pick them up naturally how they go in my hand. You can make some quick adjustments if you have to, but don't just take your mallets and put them uniformly all the exact same length in a straight line, because that's not how you pick them up. I can adjust them quickly that way, but I prefer them as if I'm gonna pick them up, okay? Now, what am I using? First off, one more thing. If you can, you'll help control your audience a little bit so they don't start clapping. One gesture, an arc movement here, don't ever look up at the audience, and then an arc movement back. I'll fix that one just a little. Now, right there's where I would probably take my breath after that A, all right? And fade it. We don't want a phrase to end like this. That sounds kind of robotic. So fade that away. Two and three and I fade and then maybe disappear on the and, so I have time to take a breath, let the hall clear for a second, but I don't want to lose my sense of rhythm too much. I will say, if you're doing this for New Jersey region and all state auditions, consider there's going to be one judge that's really not worried about the music very much and just sitting there going, one and three, four, one, and just counting the beats, even though you're playing a chorale. Now, chorales should have a sense of rhythm. I've heard people play chorales where I could never tell where the beat was. We don't want that, because it has to have forward motion and then pull back sometimes, and you need rhythm. But you can stretch and pull, but you might be criticized. So on the safe side, let's do it with the counting. One and two and three and four and one, two and three and four and one and two and four and one and two and three and four and one. Okay, so I'm counting, but I'm still leaving some space to breathe. For me to breathe as if I'm playing this on the clarinet or singing it even better, and for the audience to breathe and for the music to breathe, all right? Now, when I fade and come back in on the fourth beat here to the G, bring the D in so soft and speed your roll up toward that G. Section, I led with the right hand with a slightly harder mallet, okay? And that is going to make it very clear out in the house. I never lead with the left hand. I shouldn't say never. In some rare cases, I may. But in general, it's the right lead. Okay, I don't want to lead with the left hand. It sounds like a pickup out in the concert hall. I'm exaggerating there, but that's what I feel like it sounds. And when I've recorded things, that's what it sounds like. So I would avoid doing that. That whole first two-voice chorale is with the it's within the piano dynamic, pretty much. Okay, piano pianissimo, maybe the G almost mezzo piano. Now with the four voices, I start soft, so it's not foreign to what I just played, but I start to pick it up pretty soon. Now, I'm laying on the right hand a little bit, and that's because my mouth down here is a little harder. These are the Concerto Burgundies. I'm not going to try and remember the numbers right now. This is the blue. This is a burgundy with some extra rubber around it and some moleskin and then some very soft yarn wrapped around it. So for the bass that I have. And again, I'm phrasing the same way. I always lift before the fourth beat pickup to the next. And I usually fade except for this next phrase. This phrase here starts off with this second in the middle, and I think it's a reminder to me that this is where I'm really going to start to build. This tension makes me want to build here. This is an even bigger interval than we talked about before, bigger than the octave, right? We have to go all the way a ninth here in the right hand. Well, it's probably about the same size as an octave in the left hand. This is tough. What am I going to do? It's technically, it's hard to reach, right? You have to have your students already practicing this Stevens exercises that they do. Let's try and be as far along as that. Starting Stevens for a few weeks or a couple of weeks, adding Yellow After the Rain, which is going to take some students a semester, but some students a few weeks. By then, let's hope we're along to those exercises in the Stevens book, where we start with just this, right? Then we're interval changing. Right? So eventually it gets us up to an octave and a third, which that's great. That's just what we need to be doing to get this spot down. So anyway, I take the mallets, these three mallets that are sticking up, and they're pretty close to the edge near the string, and I'm going to bring this one out over the pipe. Now, it's a step harder than these other mallets, at least, and it's over the pipe, so that's going to help that voice to come out, because there's a lot of times where I don't hear it come out. When people play, it's covered up completely by, you know. You can barely hear it. So I'm going to make every effort. I'm going to push on it a little bit with my hand, with my thumb, and I'm going to play the other voices toward the string a little. The first statement of this, I play a little stronger so that I can really have room to fade away throughout these phrases. And just go back and forth, you know. Fast enough that you don't sound like this. And practice that. All right, and practice fading. To get that voice to come out, what's some other things I could do? One hand roll, maybe? I have have to say, I've done a lot of different ways with this, fooling around with it. What I just did, where you're just playing back and forth, I think is the best sound. But let's see. Player, that one hand roll might not be too good yet, but it's a nice start, because eventually if they play frogs or something, they'll have already done some one hand roll exercises. A ripple, I really don't like it. Sorry to influence you, I shouldn't have said that, right? It's almost distracting. Okay, I just don't think I like it very much. So, now listen, if you're going to teach, I have had one student that had a very small hand, and we kind of just fudged it a little. I offered this. I think this is what the student did. We got the octave. It was cool. That was fine. We went to both Cs. Listen. So I don't think it hurt his score, but his hand was very small. I wouldn't do that unless I had to, you know, physically. Maybe you got a list piece on the piano and your hand's too small and you might have to do a little. It's kind of the same idea. All right, so fade that away. As you fade, make sure we hear that D, okay, up to the end, and then again an arc. And then up. Now, what do we have here at the very end? Let me see. I know I like to play the downbeat, because the other accents to me don't make as much sense if I don't do the downbeat. So, and I only do two bars there. I like to fade it with a ritardando. There's a staccato, I think, on the last note, right? Right there. And I think that I like that sometimes in certain halls, but I haven't been doing it lately. I'm going to be doing this for young people's concerts starting in April, and I have a set of Indian bells. I've tried them on everything, because I think it's supposed to be around the ankles, but I wear them on my wrists, and I think it sounds pretty cool with the Indian bells on the wrists. And for a young people's concert, you need more color and more exciting different things going on. So, and I figured it out where I can just put them on without the straps having to take so long to put on. So, and it works. And when you do the rolls, I kind of move my arm a little and it shakes the bells at the same time. So I like it. So this is Rain Dance, and I highly recommend this piece if you're a teacher. Right after Yellow, After the Rain, and right before a Musser etude, like the one in B major, or the whole tone etude, or the one in C major for four mallets. So that's Rain Dance. And if you have any questions, just feel free to write me and I'll get back to you. Bye-bye.